నమస్కారం. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయ విద్యార్థులకు స్వాగతం.
The Department of Zoology, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University, is presenting a lesson on snakes for the use of B.Sc. second year zoology students of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. This lesson is broadcast in collaboration with the Friends of Snake Society, Hyderabad. Today we have invited two resource persons from that organization, that is the Friends of Snake Society. One, Mr. Rajkumar. He is the founder and general secretary of Friends of Snake Society. And the second resource person is Mr. Sai Kumar, and he is known as a film artist to everyone in AP. And he is the vice president of this Friends of Snake Society, Hyderabad. And thank you very much, sir, for coming all the way to our studios. And we will continue this lesson with live demonstrations which are brought from the Friends of Snake Society. Snakes are classified in the kingdom Animalia, phylum Cardata, group Craniata, subphylum Vertebrata, division Gnathostomata, superclass Tetrapoda, class Reptilia, subclass Diapsida, superorder Lepidosauria, order Squamata, suborder Ophidia. The squamates are the most recent and diverse products of diapsid evolution, making up approximately 95% of all known living reptiles. The snakes appeared during Cretaceous period, probably from a group of lizards whose descendants include Gila monster and monitor lizards. One can observe two specializations in particular to the snakes. One is the extreme elongation of the body and accompanying displacement and rearrangement of the organs. And the second one is the highly kinetic skull and the feeding apparatus of the snakes. The feeding apparatus of the snakes, which is specialized for eating the large prey, that is, many of the skull bones are so loosely articulated so that the entire skull can flex asymmetrically to accommodate the oversized prey. Now, let us have a quick look on few important general characters of the snakes. The snakes are entirely limbless, but there is one exception, that is, the boas have a tiny spurs around the cloaca that are the remnants of the hind limbs. The body of the snakes is covered by scales. In some cases, the head is covered by large scales. The snakes move by pushing against the objects with specialized scales of their bellies called scutes or ventral plates. These scales covering the body prevent the excessive dehydration by retaining the body moisture and contain pigments that form the color patterns of the snakes. Another interesting part is the snakes have no mobile eyelids, and therefore they can never blink or close their eyes. A single transparent scale covering the eyes. They do not have external ears also, but they can hear by sensing vibrations through the bones in their head. The most peculiar characters, the snakes can taste the air and ground using their forked tongue. Particles picked up by the tongue are processed by the Jacobson's organs in the roof of the mouth. And if you see the habits and habitats of all the snakes, the tropical and subtropical countries are the homes of most of the snakes, both of the venomous and non-venomous varieties. Different types of snakes have different physical characteristics that help them survive and succeed in their particular habitats. Let us have a quick look in the distinguishing characters of non-poisonous snakes. There are three non-poisonous snakes included in your syllabus, that is Eryx johnii, Python mollurus and tires mucosis.
Okay, so this snake is called the red sand boa, and otherwise the scientific name is called Eryx johnii. So the speciality of this snake is its tail resembles its head, as you can see here. The tail, this is the tail and this is the head. So the tail resembles the head, and because of this it can fool its predators in matter. So what happens when a predator attacks this snake? This snake actually buries its head deep under the soil and it wags its tail about in the air like this. So because of this, the predator gets fooled into thinking that this is the head and it attacks the head. And the snake slowly eventually digs into the soil and slips away. But as you can see here, it has a shovel like nose part which will enable the snake to easily dig in the water. So basically this is a, you know, underground snake, you can say. In Telugu it's called rendu talala paamu, but actually as you see it doesn't have two heads, it just has one head and one tail. The tail is also quite blunt. You can actually see some previous injuries here on the snake which the predators have left here. So that's about the red sand boa.
Eryx johnii, classified in the phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Sphamata, family Boidae. The body of the snake is short and flat and chocolate in color, and it is neither venomous nor aggressive. The head is blunt, non-distinguished from the neck. The eyes are very small with vertical pupil, the nostrils like a slit. Tail is blunt and looks like the head. When threatening or prey approaches, the snake coils into a ball and raises its tail as a false head to deflect attack from real head. Python Molurus. Python, classified in the phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Squamata, family Boidae. Python Molurus is a non-venomous snake of the Boidae family, found in the tropical regions of Africa, Asia, Australia and South Pacific Islands. The color of the python is brown above with rhomboid dark grey edged spots on the body, and the ventral side is greyish with yellow brown blotches. The scales are in smooth rows. The ventral scales are distinctly smaller, indicates its non-poisonous nature. The head is distinct from the neck and is covered with symmetrical shields or small scales. Supralabials are 11 to 13. They kill the birds, mammals, and on which they feed by squeezing them in their coils. Unlike boas, pythons are egg layers. The female coils her body over the eggs for the 6 to 8 week incubation period.
This is the common rat snake. Actually, we consider him as one of the most important snakes in India, because he's basically called the rat snake because he eats a large number of rodents, that is basically preys on rats. So he's a great help in especially in our country where most of the people either directly or indirectly depend on agriculture. This is one of the most important snakes because he's completely harmless. He's called the common rat snake. Basically he's known scientifically as Theas mucosus. He's quite a common snake found all over the country, and basically it's a large number of rodents. The only venomous snake that he does resemble is the cobra, but that is basically due to the coloration. But cobras generally have a uniform color and they won't have these dark colored crossbars that you see on this particular snake. So rat snakes, another thing is rat snakes grow much larger than cobras. Common cobras grow to a maximum length of about 6.5 feet, whereas a rat snake could attain lengths of something like 10 or even 11 feet. They're quite large, agile snakes. And rat snakes are not only important because they control the number of rodents in fields and farms. They also control the number of venomous snakes like cobras, because both of them share the same territory. And many a time a large rat snake will kill and eat a baby cobra to eliminate competition. So being completely harmless, non-venomous snakes, they're actually very useful because they help us in two ways. One is controlling the dangerously venomous cobras and probably other venomous snakes, and also of course by controlling the number of rodents, that is rats and mice, which eat away about 25% to 30% of India's food grain produced every year.
Tyres mucosis. Tyres mucosis, classified in the phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Squamata, family Colubridae. Tyres mucosis is commonly called as Dhaman or rat snake of India. It is brown above, often with black cross bands on the posterior part of the body. The tail and underparts are yellowish in color. The scales in the body formed as rows. Head is distinct from the neck. The eyes are large with round pupil. Fourth and fifth labials are touching the eye. It is a oviparous animal which can lay the eggs. Now come to the poisonous snakes. Poisonous snakes are usually divided into three groups based on the type of fangs.
This is a Russell's viper. He's got a very stout body. They grow to about 5.5 feet in length. That's one way of recognizing a Russell's viper, is these very regular rhomboids that he has on the body. And of course the ventral scales are full, they cover the full length of the body, unlike the sand, unlike like in the sand boa, which is non-venomous. He's got ventral scales which cover only half of the width of the lower body of the snake, the underbelly of the snake. So the belly scales in Russell's vipers are full sized, and that's the anus of the snake. And after that, unlike as in the crate, you can see that the subcaudals are divided. Subcaudals in this snake of course are paired, so they are actually in two parts. You can see this line running in the middle. So there's actually half a scale this side and half a scale this side. So they're two separate scales after the vent. And before the vent, of course, the scales are full in size. As far as the head of the snake is concerned, you can see that he's got a very triangular shaped head, which is typical of all vipers. So if you come across a Russell's or a saw-scale viper who doesn't have shields on the head, unlike other snakes, they have large scales on top of the head. Fangs that are actually, they lie against the roof of the mouth of the snake when they're not in use. But when the snake wants to use them, he actually unhinges them like that. I'm actually using the same muscle that the snake uses. I'm actually stimulating that muscle so that the fang is, you know, erect. Now you can see that. Alright, so you can see now as I stimulate the muscle at the back, the fang comes into position for biting. Otherwise the fang actually lies against the roof of the mouth of the snake when the mouth is closed. And once the snake actually gets his teeth onto a victim, then the sheath automatically moves back. And under this sheath, you can see that he's got a very, very large fang. That's the fang of a Russell's viper.
Vipera russelli, Russell's viper. The viper is classified in the phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Squamata, family Viperidae. The members of this family Viperidae have highly developed tubular fangs in front of the mouth. The snake, when fully grown, is unmistakable. It has thick body like python, often up to 150 millimeters thick, with dark brown diamond-shaped markings that run in three rows. The head is triangular and covered with very small imbricate scales on the upper surface. The snout is angulate and the nasal opening is quite prominent. The eyes are with golden iris and elliptical pupil. The supralabials are 10 to 12 and fourth supralabial is the largest and it does not touch the eye. These snakes are viviparous animals. They lay their shelled elliptical eggs beneath the rotten logs under the rocks. These are carnivorous, feeding mainly on small mammals, mice, rats, lizards and birds. When threatened, it coils up and hisses loudly and continuously. The second family of poisonous snakes, family Elapidae, The members of this family are Indian cobra, common crate. This has short, permanently erectile fangs so that the venom must be injected by chewing. One must study the elegance and the fiery lifestyles of cobra, biological name Naja Naja, to understand the royal and divine status attributed to this animal. Cobra is classified in phylum Chordata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Squamata, family Elapidae. Body is elongated. The color of the body is brown or blackish. The head is not differentiated from the neck. Neck is dilatable and the cervical ribs are elongated. The expansion of the neck and the cervical ribs form the hood. The upper surface of the hood bears a binocellate mark, which can be called as a mark of spectacle. This is the characteristic feature of the cobra or Naja Naja. The eyes are very small and with round pupils. The third supralabial is large and touches the eye and the nasal shield. This is the important characteristic feature of the cobra. The poisonous fangs are followed by 1 to 3 small teeth. The tail is cylindrical and tapering posteriorly. The subchordals form 2 rows. It is oviparous animal and it is also a carnivorous animal, feeding on frogs, lizards, rats and other snakes. This snake can grow a maximum length of 1.5 meters. And this snake is often confused with the non-poisonous rat snake, that is Tyrus mucosus.
This is the common crate. Basic way of identifying this snake is, of course, by its color and by the white bands that you can see on the latter part of the body. And by the scalation, of course, you can see this large hexagonal scale right on top. You know, it's hexagonal shaped and it's quite large, much larger than the other scales. Runs right on top of the back of the snake. So this is one of the positive identification by scalation you can do for a common crate. In fact, all crates have this large hexagonal scale running in a line right on top of the body. Secondly, if you notice the tail end of the snake, he'll have this, you can see this is the ventral scale, the vent. And after the vent, you can see that all the scales, the subchordals are not divided. Look at the tail region of the snake. You'll see that the after the anal scale, this is the anal scale right here. You can see that the this is the anal scale, that's the anus of the snake. Ventral scales, all these are full scales, and even after the anus they continue to be full till the tip of the tail. So this is another positive identification of the crate. And of course, as far as the head is concerned, it's got a small rounded head, and they've got pretty small fangs actually, which I'll try and show you. Okay. Now you can see that he's got a small, very small head, and you can see those fangs inside there, right on top of the mouth. One on the left and one on the right, you can see pretty tiny fangs. They're actually short fixed fangs that have very limited mobility. And basically they're connected to a venom gland that's situated right behind the eye right there. And that's where he stores his venom. And there's a duct that leads to the base of the fang. And when the snake bites, he actually creates a hole with the fang through which he the venom actually trickles down the side of the fang. So he's got what are known as gutter fangs. He doesn't have a fang that delivers venom at the tip, but it delivers at the base, and the venom actually runs down the side of the fang.
Bangaris is commonly called the crate. Body is elongated and slender. The color of the body is teal blue with narrow cross bars and white specks on the dorsal side. And on the ventral side, it is uniform white in color. The head is with normal shields and is not differentiated from the neck. Eyes are moderate size with narrow pupil. The third and fourth supralabials are touching the eye and they are very large. And the fourth infralabial is also very large. The scales are smooth and arranged in rows. An enlarged chain of dorsal hexagonal scales are present on the dorsal side of the body. The ventral scales beyond the anal region are in a single row. These snakes are oviparous. and carnivorous animals. They feed on rats, snakes, and lizards. Crotalus rattlesnake. The rattlesnake is classified in the phylum Cardata, subphylum Vertebrata, class Reptilia, order Squamata, family Crotalinae. Crotalus is commonly called as rattlesnake, found in South America and North Mexico. The general color of the body is gray-brown with dark bands. The body is very elongated. The head is distinct from the neck. Tongue is forked. The upper surface of the head is covered with small scales. The most distinguishing feature of this rattlesnake is the presence of needle-shaped fangs. The presence of rattle at the end of the tail is the most distinctive feature. Rattle is formed by the union of 10 to 12 hollow segments of the dry, horny skin. This rattlesnake is viviparous and it is deadly poisonous, and it is a carnivorous and nocturnal animal. It feeds on small mammals, but deadly to larger animals, even to human beings also, if it is provoked. Now we'll discuss about the poisonous apparatus of a venomous snake. The poisonous apparatus of any venomous snake comprises a pair of poison glands, their ducts, and the fangs. If you observe the poisonous gland, the poisonous gland is present on both the sides of the head, and this is the modified supralabial gland, and it is covered by a capsule of fibrous tissue, and the gland is divided into a secretory pockets called poisonous lakes. The entire poisonous gland is covered by a fan-shaped muscle called cryptomandibularis superficialis muscle. The contraction of this muscle facilitates the poison to flow from the poisonous gland to the duct and from there to the fang. And if you observe the fang is a grooved or tubular and is perfectly adapted to inject the poison into the body of the victim. The poison or venom enters the fang through the intake aperture and then flows through the canal of the fang. Finally, the poison is injected into the victim through the subterminal discharge aperture of the fang.
Got short fixed fangs which he uses to actually create a wound in whatever is biting. So basically we've taken a glass here, covered it with a membrane, and we make the snake actually bite the glass, and that's how he actually injects his venom. And as you can see, if I actually, you know, stimulate the venom sacs a little bit, he actually injects plenty of venom into the glass.
What is the composition of the venom? Snake venom is secreted by the glands of snake is a complex organic compound. Its color is yellow. It has no taste or smell. It contains 30% of the poisonous proteins dissolved in organic acid. The venom secreted by different poisonous snakes have their own characteristic toxicity. Venom of sea snakes, cobra, crate is neurotoxic. It affects the respiratory system, acting on the nervous system. Both optic and phrenic nerves are affected, leading to blindness and asphyxiation, that is a respiratory paralysis. The viper venom is hemotoxic. It affects the heart, breaks the red blood corpuscles and dissolves the endothelium capillaries, causing the hemorrhage and coagulation. Although thousands of persons are bitten by venomous snakes every year throughout India, most bites occur when people are trying to kill or handle the snakes. What do snakes eat? All snakes are carnivorous, preying upon variety of different animals including the snakes, fish, frogs, salamanders, rodents, insects, birds, and slugs. Snakes use sharp teeth and strong muscles to catch the prey. If the prey animal is bigger than the snake's mouth, sometimes the snake can unhinge its bottom of the jaw to feed the big animal into its mouth. The larger snake, that is python, which do not have any appendages to grip and hold the prey, is developed an intriguing method for capturing, immobilizing and killing its prey. These snakes are able to kill their prey by constriction, thereby suffocating their victim, then swallow it slowly. Snakes have a very important role in Indian mythology. In India, there is a festival called Nagapanchami that is dedicated to the purpose of worshipping the snakes.
Actually, snakes do not drink milk. Milk is not a part of the snake's diet. But on Nagapanchami day, snakes drink milk. Adindukante, these our snake charmers, they catch all these cobras 2 months or 3 months prior to Nagapanchami festival, and they stitch up the mouths and they defang the snake, take out the venom sacs and the fangs and stitch up the mouth also for their safety, and they starve the snake for two to three months time. So during this time, what happens, the snake is severely dehydrated. It's not given even a drop of water. Since snakes can live to somewhere around 2-3 months without food and this, but water is very essential, but then it's like they are in the last stage of their life. So what these guys do, after removing all that and stitching up the mouth, they just keep the snake for a month or so with them, and they get that severely dehydrated snake to your doorstep. So when such a snake is introduced to a saucer of milk or whatever fluid, for example, you can actually give it tea, coffee, Sprite, thumbs up, anything, it will drink. Because it's in such a severely dehydrated state, it will actually have any fluid given to it. So milk anedi, it's a wrong this thing and wrong concept. Snakes do not drink milk. Their general food is rats, lizards, and bigger snakes like pythons eat bandicoots or chickens and things like that. But milk and other cooked offerings that we keep giving on Nagapanchami day is not a part of the snake's diet.
Okay, thank you very much for coming all the way to our studios.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Maa karyakramalapai mee soochanalu salahalu telichayati. Maa chirunama director, ఆడియో విజువల్ ప్రొడక్షన్ అండ్ రీసెర్చ్ సెంటర్, డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ, ప్రొఫెసర్ జి రామరెడ్డి మార్క్, రోడ్ నంబర్ 46, జూబ్లీ హిల్స్, హైదరాబాద్ 500303.